Peace, family. This is African Esquire TV. I'm your host, Tierney Cherie. I was on the internet yesterday, like I'm sure some of you also were, and I saw a tweet by Bobby Wine, and we have to come and discuss this because now we have to completely reframe who this person is. Now, some of you are going to tell me, I already told you so, Tierney. I already told you this is not the person that you thought he was. And let me just go through the history of Bobby Wine really quickly. So Bobby Wine came out a couple years ago, and I had not known him for very long. But when he did come out, he was running against the current president of Uganda, Museveni. If you don't know, the current president of Uganda is someone who is absolutely a United States puppet, okay? This is someone who has no love for his people. This is someone who is beholden to Western capitalist imperialist interests. He is not there to liberate the people. He's there to continue the system and allow the people to remain oppressed under Western imperialism. This has to be emphasized because this is not a president that we want to see in power. This is someone that I very much cannot wait till the people of Uganda are able to push him out and have someone who represents their true needs. That's something that has to be emphasized. So when you have someone who has been president for way too long, I mean, I think it was like 4 or 5 United States presidents have sat with this man still being president of Uganda. Someone who sat for way too long oppressing the people and being an imperialist puppet, that has to be emphasized again. And you have someone young come out with apparently having the support of the people on the ground in Uganda, and he's coming out, he's challenging this president. So when I first heard about this, of course, when I first reported, I was very much, I was encouraged, first of all, because you don't see a lot of people who are coming out outwardly against these people who are very much have shown through track records, they are willing to take your life quickly, and that the international community will turn a blind eye to this situation because they support, again, the regime that continues the same old status quo. Well, this happens, and essentially what happens, if you don't remember, Bobby Wine basically gets arrested by Museveni. He gets beat up very, very bad by his soldiers. Please look all this up just to get the details. I'm trying to run through this quickly. But he's very severely incapacitated by what happens when he's in custody. So he goes to the United States for treatment. That automatically, I would say, did seem odd to me, because if we're going to look at the people who the United States actually does accept in for asylum, for some type of treatment, it's most African leaders are completely disqualified. Most people are literally ignored whenever these things happen. So that was interesting. But again, me trying to be an optimist about African liberation, I didn't want to necessarily look at that as being a reason to suggest that this man is not for the interest of Africa. Well, while he's in the United States, you see him meeting with a lot of leaders. You also see him go over to Europe, and he's also meeting with a lot of leaders. He's going to places where a lot of Africans would never go. And when you see someone making all of these appeals to the European power structure, the common sense thing for me was always, if you are so concerned about the conditions of the people in Uganda, and I would hope Africa as a continent, then you would all automatically go to criticize, to call out, to bring light to the imperialist relationships that exist. But if your sole purpose is to call out Museveni and not to call out the people who are funding him, the people who are funding, who will continue to fund whoever replaces him, if that's not what you're calling out, the system that exists, then that's something that's concerning. But again, being an optimist, maybe he doesn't know. You know, you try to think maybe this person is just not aware. I mean, I know for me at one time in my life, and maybe most of you, I did think that of most of the things that were told to me of European society, of American society, that this is a place of democracy or something, and that these are the ideals that we should aspire to. I believed all that hype at one time, and I'm sure most of you have, because the propaganda machine is very strong for a colonized person. So maybe he just doesn't know yet. Maybe he doesn't have the awareness yet. Maybe he really thinks that the Europeans care about him, care about the people of Uganda. Maybe he's just gullible. So then we go to another election cycle. Bobby Wine again, running against Museveni. Very clearly, from the start, Museveni is basically showing you are not going to get any traction. You see him arresting this guy, Bobi Wine, consistently. Again, while the international community is watching. And that's the other thing that was kind of complicated, because if the United States is focused on getting Museveni out of power, as some of you have said, I've heard it said that Bobi Wine is a United States puppet and that he's really just here for regime change. But they've had a lot of opportunities to step in, meaning like they could have said, oh, you need to allow fair elections. They could have sent in their emissaries. Like they could have completely unseated Museveni if they wanted to. So that's another thing that added another complication, is that from what it looks like, the United States is still supporting Museveni. The Western countries are still supporting him. The other puppet governments are still supporting him. So we really can't suggest or be sure, at least, that Bobi Wine is here for regime change. Now, so some more traction comes Bobby Wine's way, and now it looks like absolutely that he does have the majority support of the people, from what you see. And I'm completely aware that I'm not on the ground, so anyone is in Uganda or from Uganda, you know, you could tell me what it actually looked like. I'm always here for learning more. But from what we saw, you know, it seemed like he definitely had a lot of the support of the people. Now, Museveni has his election. He wins again. And from what it looks like, it was very clearly fraud. I don't know if you've seen, there's a video of going through all the ballots, and it's like Museveni, 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 Museveni. So it's very clearly like this person probably and most likely committed fraud to ensure that he won this election. An added layer to that is that while this is happening, while he wins the election, he puts his opposition on house arrest. And of course, if you won the election, why would you be putting someone on house arrest while you're counting ballots? Like, that doesn't make sense. So clearly, you know, something is wrong. So clearly this election is botched. And I still believe that that election was botched. I still believe that this was a way for Museveni to completely steal the election from the people. But now we have some new developments. So, you know, while Bobi Wine's in house arrest, he gets a visit, I forget from who, but from an ambassador from a European country. Okay, that's always interesting, because how often do we see people who are fighting for the struggle in Africa get visits while they're on house arrest or in jail from an ambassador? So that was interesting. And then this new thing came out, and that kind of added another layer to it. I mean, I've been seeing a lot of European institutions, you know, championing him. I've been seeing news stories discussing him. And that's something that's always interesting when you look at the Western press, how they're very selective on anything they cover from Africa. More than likely, they're going to only cover things that are going to support the capitalist system. So then all of this culminates into the situation that you have that was just revealed today, yesterday, actually. So Bobi Wine releases a tweet, and he had a meeting with Juan Guaido, who is a imperialist puppet and probably the most brazen example of imperialism today. I'm going to very quickly go through why this is concerning, because I think a lot of our people, first of all, some of us do not pay attention to things that happen outside of Africa or so outside of people who are African. And if that's the case, you're really missing a lot of what's going on as far as fighting imperialism. And particularly, although we may look at the situation of Venezuela as not being something that affects Africa, our people have to understand why this is an important issue and why this is an issue that we have to know now that this is where Bobi Wine stands. Juan Guaido, right? Okay. I've gone over the story a few times. Going to go over it really quickly again. So essentially, the United States hates Nicolas Maduro, who is the current president of Venezuela. They hate him the same way they hated the previous president of Venezuela, Hugo Chavez. Why? Because Venezuela is a socialist country, and America obviously hates socialism. Why does America hate socialism? The reason why America hates socialism is because whenever you have a country saying we're going to nationalize our resources, we're going to nationalize our gold, we're going to nationalize our oil, We're going to nationalize everything that you people want. That completely thwarts the capitalist mindset that we're going to go into your country and buy up your industries, and we're going to have private ownership over something that's in your country. So whenever you have a people saying we want all the private companies gone, we're going to nationalize this thing so that we could make sure our people benefit, that's always going to be something that makes the West retaliate. And that's what you've seen consistently. You've seen that in Venezuela. You've seen this in Grenada. You've seen this so many places over and over again, because imperialism will not allow these things to slip. If you are someone who's going to stand up and say, we want ownership of our resources for our people collectively, the answer is always going to be, how do we get this guy out of here? Because one, we don't want any situation where someone is telling us that we can't access their resources. And two, we certainly do not want these ideologies to spread. Because if you think about something like Cuba, the reason why Cuba has been so attacked by the United States is because if Cuba were allowed to fully shine the way that it should, meaning if they were not given sanctions, if they were not attacked on every single front from the Western imperialists, then that would be a testament to the people around the world that, hey, socialism does work. Hey, it actually, you can have a society where you do have people who are collectively owning the means of production. You can have a society where the government represents the people, not just as far as a vote every 4 years, but represents their economic interests collectively. That is a threat. And so anytime that is manifested, you're going to see it being attacked. Okay, going back to Venezuela. So Hugo Chavez, Nicolas Maduro, enemies of the United States. We're not going to allow you to access our resources. We're not going to allow you to overtake our country. We're going to have a country that focuses on servicing the people. Well, what is the response of America? This was Trump at the time. They find this guy named Juan Guaido. And Juan Guaido is going to allow, obviously, the people to come in, the private capitalists to come in and buy up the resources if he becomes president. Now, this man was not even elected of anything. Literally, the United States finds this guy and they say, hey, you're going to be the president of Venezuela. But there wasn't an election. Doesn't matter. You're the president of Venezuela. So what does the United States do? They go to all their allies. This guy's the president of Venezuela. The people of Venezuela are like, we didn't elect him. So what? We're going to say this is the president of Venezuela. Nicolas Maduro, you're no longer the president of Venezuela. We do not acknowledge you. What happens is the Europeans literally freeze the assets in Venezuela. They cannot access them. Why can't we access our assets that are inside of European banks? Well, Nicolas Maduro, you're not the president anymore. Juan Guaido is. This is the situation. Do you understand how dangerous this is? First of all, it's a precedent and something that we as African people cannot let slip. Second of all, understanding that any type of liberation movement, the Europeans who control the commerce, the Europeans who control the military, the Europeans who control the world, can say, hey, to your revolution, we don't acknowledge you. We're going to acknowledge this guy who speaks for us, who we like, who is going to allow us to do what we want. That guy is going to be the president.
We are supporting the hopes of Cubans, Nicaraguans, and Venezuelans to restore democracy. The United States is leading a 59-nation diplomatic coalition against the socialist dictator of Venezuela, Nicolas Maduro. Maduro is an illegitimate ruler, a tyrant who brutalizes his people, but Maduro's grip on tyranny will be smashed and broken. Here this evening is a very brave man who carries with him the hopes, dreams, and aspirations of all Venezuelans. Joining us in the gallery is the true and legitimate president of Venezuela, Juan Guaido. Mr. President, please take this message back to your family.
And therefore, we're going to completely isolate you, and we're going to tell everyone that you are no longer legitimate. This person who we picked, not the people who we picked, is legitimate. And I've yet to hear anyone in the United States government even give a fake reason, like give a reason. Why would you guys completely say that this guy is the president, you know, give us some type of fabrication, because the fact that you were so bold as to say that this person wasn't elected, but we're going to make him the president, it just shows just the arrogance of these people, the arrogance of people like Trump, of people like Joe Biden. And this is something that Joe Biden, by the way, because Trump released inside of an article, he said that, you know what, maybe I didn't work with Nicolas Maduro the way I should have. Maybe I should have tried to work with him a little more, you know, maybe this whole Juan Guaido thing, or maybe that was a dumb mistake, right? Trump being transparent, as he is sometimes. And Biden actually retweets this statement from Trump and saying, oh, how dare he say that he's going to negotiate with this dictator. If I'm president, I'm going to make sure that I go hard on Maduro. This is Biden, the person who's supposed to be this liberal, whatever liberal means, okay? So I hope I painted the picture for you. This guy Juan Guaido is, just look at it as the embodiment of white supremacy, the embodiment of colonialism, the embodiment of imperialism. Anyone who supports him is supporting the system of oppression that oppresses Africans, period. Now, there's two different explanations, obviously. Maybe we can also, once again, say, oh, maybe Bobby Wine didn't know. You know, maybe he was under the impression that this really was the guy who was the president of Venezuela. I mean, all the Europeans are saying this is the president of Venezuela. The Americans say it. So, you know, he's not from the Western Hemisphere. Maybe he knew. But at this point, I'm done giving Bobby Wine the benefit of the doubt. You know, maybe you can still. I'm done. The reason is because I've just seen him in too many compromising situations for me to think that this is a person who is actually going to fight colonialism, fight imperialism. And I'm just tired of looking the other way. You know, it's one thing if, you know, hey, maybe I misunderstood the situation. Maybe I wrongly assumed that these people who were of the capitalist class, that they're going to do right by us. So let me try to draw back. But as we've seen more and more, he's just pushing more and more into being an American lapdog, more and more. And this is something that can never be good for our people. If we're talking about true liberation, this type of person who is willing to bow to imperialist interest. And, you know, again, let me emphasize, the biggest issue I've always had with him, and let me also say, I'm not going to name people just as now, but there are other people, you know, who I've heard being voices of liberation, supposedly, right? The biggest problem I've always had with him is to put so much emphasis on the puppet Museveni, who we all agree needs to be done away with, putting so much emphasis on him, but not the system that creates him. How do I know that you are not going to get into this position? How do the people of Uganda know that you're not going to get into this position and do just like him or even worse? So, of course, let's just say I already said there's a possibility maybe he didn't know. I don't believe that anymore. But let's say he did know. He does know who the situation in Venezuela, and he's purposely going out for the West. He's purposely pursuing what they want him to do. Then at that point, you don't have a better situation with him or Museveni. You don't have something more comforting. We know now that your interests are not with the people. Your interests are with the white capitalists. So, you know, I hope I laid this out, because I understand that I've done videos. I would say the first video I did was like supporting Bobby Wine. The second one, not so much, because after I started seeing him doing, you know, a lot of meetings with certain people, it didn't feel necessarily organic. And so I instead, you know, put my emphasis on the people of Uganda who deserve someone better than Museveni. And if that be Bobby Wine, fine. But if not, then let's have someone better. We have to change the system. But now I'm saying that we have to understand that people who are allowing themselves to be aligned with Western interests in such a brazen way, we really have to make sure that we have a clear understanding of who they are. African freedom has to be African freedom from the system completely, and not partially, but in every single facet of what freedom, autonomy, self-determination means. That means that the imperialists lose all say over Africa. That means that the capitalists lose all holds over Africa. That means that the people who are historically the colonizers no longer have any power inside of these regions. These are the things that we're asking for. These are the things that we must demand. And we can't be compromising with our liberation. We have to be as militant as the situation calls for. And when you look at how many of our people are dying, starving, how many of our people are going at war with each other because of the system, I say it takes all the militancy in you to directly face this system. That is all I have on this. I'm sure a lot of you, I'm going to get a bunch of I told you so. So, hey, you know, go ahead. But I will see you guys in the next video. Hey, family, this is Tierney Cherie. I'm here to make an announcement that I'm very, very excited to make. I'm excited because I really think this is something that is important for our people. Otherwise, I would not have devoted so much time and energy towards it. So I finished my first book, and the book title is Fostering False Identity, The Child Welfare System's Design of Social Control of the Black Family. Now, why is this book something that I think will be very important for our community? Well, number one, it's dealing with the system of white supremacy, particularly the way that the system has targeted our children. If you don't know, our children are literally our future. Without our children, we have no future. And so understand that the system is very crafty when figuring out what to derail first. And to me, it's no mistake that the system particularly went after the Black family. If you look at what happened whenever we were enslaved by this system and continues to continues to go after Black children, continues to try to villainize African parents. So for that, I wanted to particularly talk about this subject. Now, the other thing that book will deal with is our African identities. Why is it that our African identities are a threat to this system? Why is it that whenever we want to identify ourselves as being African, we get so much drawback inside of the Black community? I think a lot of us are not aware of the history of assimilationist thought inside of our community, this idea that we have to be close to white in order to be accepted. And so that's another subject that we delve into in this book. So I'm hoping that anyone who is, obviously, if you're a parent, a Black parent, and you really want to understand why it is that these systems are going after your children, I encourage you to read this book. I hope that it will arm you with a lot of knowledge and a lot of foresight, not just about how to protect your own children, but how to organize in your community, because that's really the purpose of the book, is to say that we have to organize among ourselves in order to protect ourselves from this white supremacist system. And then obviously, if you're an organizer in general, this is something that I think is important for you to read, because like I said, this is a subject in the Black community that we just don't discuss enough. Child welfare is not something that is going to get enough attention. People, obviously, we organize them around other causes, but this is one that is really important that I feel like we have to pay more attention to.